So you may have read in your newsfeed news about changing environment, perhaps climate change, perhaps even ecology. But what do any of those actually mean? Well, start by ecology. So ecology is a field of biology and such to science. So the science that studies the abiotic and biotic conditions that allow organisms to survive and reproduce. Such ecologists like myself study the way organisms interact with one another, how they eat each other, whether they compete with one another, perhaps even whether they help each other through a symbiosis or mutualistic interaction, but also how they interact with their environment. For example, plants need sunlight to grow. That's their abiotic environment. And in the absence of that, they can't grow, they can't reproduce, they're gonna die. Cows, on the other end, they need to eat plants to grow and survive. All of those organism-to-organism interaction, but also organism-to-environment type of interactions are the kind of things that ecologists study. So ecologists study the physiology and biology of individual organisms, but also collection of organisms of the same species, which we call populations. Now, collections of populations that interact with one another through predation, competition, those are communities. And then communities and their abiotic environment, that's an ecosystem. Collections of ecosystems, all the ecosystems in the world, that's what we call the biosphere. So ecology is in and of itself a really interesting word. It comes from the Greek oikos, which means house, and logos, the study. So ecology literally means the study of the house, our house, this biosphere we inhabit. So ecologists are really intent not only understanding the biosphere, but also taking care of it. So one of the things that ecologists study is whether populations will increase or decrease over time. And the reason as to why we care about that is that because we ourselves actually rely on other populations, populations from other species, to survive and reproduce. Like, we eat other organisms all the time. We grow other organisms all the time. So the conditions that allow these organisms to grow or, you know, decrease to extinction is really something we care about. So there's many ways as to which we can study populations. We could go there into the field and count individuals of the same species over time. That would allow us to tell whether a population is increasing or decreasing. There's other ways you may not necessarily have thought of. For example, we actually rely on mathematical models, not only to understand how these populations will grow over time, but also to predict their fate. So let's talk about the simplest possible ecological model. Math is your friend. So let's dissect a simple model together. Let's assume we could go out there in the field and count individuals over time. And we'll do that over equal time intervals. So T0 will have n naught individuals, T1 will have n1 individuals, T2, n2, and so forth. Now, that in and of itself would give us some information as to what the population is doing, but we would lack understanding. So to gain understanding as to what's going on, let's start by dividing the number of individuals at one time step by the number of individuals at the previous time step as a measure of how much the population grew from one time to the next. Let's call that number lambda. So lambda 1 equals n1 over n naught. If that number is above 1, it's larger than 1. That means that n1 is larger than n0. If the number is equal to 1, it means that the population didn't grow. And if the number is smaller than 1, it actually means that the population decreased from t0 to t1. So if we do a bit of algebra, we multiply both sides by n0, and you know we cancel n0s out, then we end up with this simple equation, which is n1 equals lambda 1 times n0. Let's do that for time 2 and see what happens. So we have lambda 2 equals n2 over n1. We multiply both sides by n1, do the algebra, we end up with n2 equals lambda 2 times n1. But n1 we saw was actually equal to lambda 1 times n0. So n2 equals lambda 2 times lambda 1 times n0. So for the sake of this exercise, let's do it just one more time to see what happens. So n3 over n2 equals lambda 3. Multiply both sides by n2, do the algebra. What we end up with is n3 equals lambda 3 times n2. But we know what n2 equals to. So what we get is n3 equals lambda 3 times lambda 2 times lambda 1 times n0. So you can see that we can do that up until an arbitrary time point t. So nt will equal lambda t times lambda t minus 1 times all the lambdas all the way to lambda 1 times n0. And then let's wrap this up by making a simple assumption, which is all these growth or decreases, all these rates of growth across all these time intervals are equal to one another for this population. So that all the lambdas equal one another. What we end up with is nt equals lambda to the power of t times n0. And that's the simplest possible model of population growth. So let's start with a simple example. Lambda equals 2. So, and let's start with an organism that can divide asexually, starting from one individual, like E. coli or any bacteria, actually. So at t0, n equals 1. N1 is 2 to the power of 1 times 1, so 2. Population is growing. At n3, we get 2 to the power of 2, so 4 times 2, 8. If we keep on doing that, you can see the population is growing really, really fast. As a matter of fact, we say the population is growing dramatically. And if this was a time continuous model, if we could do this, you know, in ridiculously small time steps, we would say the population is growing exponentially. Now, what happens if lambda equals 1? Well, at first we have n0, n0 equals 1. Then n1 equals 1 to the power of 1 times 1, so 1. At n2, we have 1 to the power of 2, so 1 times 1, so 1. So you can see the population isn't changing over time. And then what happens when lambda is actually smaller than 1? Well, you can see the population is actually decreasing. So this very simple model allows us to say something really powerful as to whether populations will increase, be stable, or decrease over time. And that's just by taking a look at how many individuals there were at the first time step, and then understanding something about their ecology, which is embodied in this lambda parameter. So basically, lambda is how many individuals can the population produce, making babies over time, minus the number of deaths. And so what? Why should we care about, you know, this abstract model of population growth? Well, among other reasons, because organisms are not independent from their abiotic environment. They're not independent from the pH of the soil they live in. They're not independent from the temperature of the water they swim in. They're not independent from, you know, the amount of sunlight that they receive. So this growth parameter lambda, that is actually a function of fecundity and death rates, is itself dependent on environmental conditions. And for a very simple reason, you know, we organisms are just a collection of cells, and cells are just bags of chemicals. Now, chemicals react with one another, and that reaction rate is strongly temperature dependent. That's called the Arrhenius law. So as temperatures increase, chemical reaction rates actually increase exponentially with temperature. Now, biological chemical reactions, which we call metabolic rates, do increase with temperature at first, and then eventually the rates decrease. And that's because the proteins, the enzymes that catalyze these reactions break down. They just cease to exist. And the same thing happens with organisms. If temperatures are too cold, we can't live in. Temperatures are just too warm, we also can't live in. We need a range of temperatures that's just right. And just right means different things for different organisms. Now, coming back to lambda, lambda itself depends on our metabolic rates. And typically, especially for cold blooded organisms, so organisms that actually cannot produce their own heat, lambda increases at first and then decreases. So the range at which populations can grow needs the temperature to be just right. So this is one of the many reasons as to why ecologists are so preoccupied with this unprecedented, rapid change in global temperatures. Because we know many organisms are actually going to be negatively affected by this temperature rise. And the problem is, because so far we don't necessarily know there's another biosphere out there, we definitely don't think we can terraform Mars fast enough for us to get out of planet Earth. You know, we really need to first understand what's going on, and second, if possible, mitigate.